Welcome to you all. Thank you for joining us today for the fourth talk in the RIBA People, Place, Planet series. This is a programme of online events and activities bringing focus to the climate emergency, sustainability and the built environment. This series is sponsored by Ibstock Brick and we're thankful for their support. Details will be posted in the chat should you wish to contact them. I'm Jane Hamlin, your host for this event and chair of RIBA Southwest. With us today, we also have Andrew Forth, RIBA Interim Director of Policy, Public Affairs and External Affairs. He will now give a short presentation on the RIBA before David's talk. Andrew, over to you.
Hi there, good morning everyone. I'm Andrew Forth and thanks Jane for the introduction. This is a really exciting time to be talking about people, place and planet, because I think rarely have politics been more interested in those things. The public and the politicians are, you know, thinking about the built environment in a way that we haven't really seen them do for quite a while. Things like COVID-19, working from home and the impact of that on how we work and where we work. The issues around building safety, which have been debated heavily in Parliament, and the challenge of the climate emergency. All of this means a lot of uncertainty for architects and for people, but I think there are also significant opportunities if we can lobby government effectively and if the voice of architects can really stand out in what is an increasingly crowded field. There are a couple of things that you might be interested at going on at the moment. The government is doing a lot of new legislation. There's a future building standard being done at the moment, which will set hopefully good progressive standards for the environmental performance of new buildings. The Building Safety Bill is about to come into Parliament, which has the potential to change how we build and the role of the architects in the construction process. There's a planning white paper which has been published, but we've not yet really seen the details of, which could fundamentally change how local communities have an input into what new developments in their area look like. And of course, we've seen huge political transformations with the Conservative Party winning seats in Labour's Northern Heartlands that we wouldn't have expected even 5 years ago to see happening. So how is the RIBA responding? Well, the flagship piece of work for us is the RIBA 2030 Challenge. It's an ambitious set of targets and resources for our members and their clients on how to reduce the impacts of new and existing buildings on the built environment. If you'd like to know more about the challenge, and if you'd like to sign up if you're an RIBA chartered practice, there's more information on our website. It's a really exciting opportunity to demonstrate leadership and to sort of make the message clear to the construction sector and to government that architects want to see change, but most importantly, that architects can help deliver that change so that we get more sustainable, safer and better quality new homes. I'm really excited to listen to the lecture later. If you've got any questions for me, I will be sticking around for the chat afterwards. Thank you very much and back to the host.
Thank you, Andrew. Now on to today's guest speaker. David Mikhail is the founding director of Mikhail Riches Architects, an award-winning practice known in particular for its high-quality residential projects. David is skilled in master planning as well as residential and mixed-use architecture. He's also experienced in passive house and low energy design and led the project team for Goldsmith Street in Norwich, which won the Stirling Prize in 2019. We're therefore delighted to have him here today to deliver our latest talk. Please put any questions you have for David or Andrew in the chat, either during the lecture or at the end. And now, without further ado, let's welcome our guest speaker, David Mikhail. David, over to you.
Thanks very much. Good morning, everyone. Right, so let's do a bit of screen sharing, shall we? Let's have a look. Just bear with me, everyone, sorry. Okay, can you all see my screen?
Yeah,
give me a thumbs up. Yeah, great, thank you. Well, thank you to the RIBA for inviting me today. Thrilled to be able to share our process with you in the Southwest, where we do have a couple of quite significant projects at the moment. And also just a word of thanks to the RIBA for their 2030 challenge. You're absolutely right when you say that it demonstrates leadership and interestingly, a lot of clients are beginning to refer to it as the kind of benchmark, the litmus test for what they should be doing. So yeah, just a note to say, well done the RIBA on that. It's really useful. So I'm going to speak for about 45 minutes. I'd rather an hour-long lecture. I was saying to the RIBA team, I'd much rather a more interactive question and answer session at the end. So I'm going to skip through a number of things. The structure of my talk is really, firstly, to talk about some of the things that have influenced us, segueing onto Goldsmith Street, and then I'll talk a little bit about our projects since Goldsmith Street, and with a bit of focus on one or two of the projects in the Southwest. So, you'll probably, most of you in the room know who this is, but those of you as old as me may remember Darth Vader's previous incarnation as the Green Cross Code Man. David Prowse, sadly no longer with us, but influential character in my childhood. And he was tasked by the government to be the face of the Green Cross Code, where actually the government took it upon themselves to illustrate for children on TV how to be safe on the roads. And that was a time when children roamed, where there's me and my little brother in our front garden. I won't tell you what year it is, but I think you can probably work it out. Let's put it this way, it's not the 70s. And, you know, there was a sense that children roamed, and we did. We roamed a lot. But we were also living in a suburban, typical suburban street. And recently, Annalie and I both went back to our childhoods via Google Earth and looked at the streets we grew up in. And we both had similar but different histories. So this was my street in Bognor Regis, of all places. And our house is on the left, the red brick one. You'll notice it's quite a wide road. And my darling little brother, Simon, interestingly got hit by a car while we were playing. I think it was Kiss Chase. I think he was running away from one of the girls across the road. You know, it was 6 months into just a hospital interaction for Simon. And I think that's always stayed with me. And I look at that house and I think about the pleasure we had, and it was never in the street. You know, the street we measured recently was 24 meters across from house to house. We never knew the families that lived over the road, really. Maybe nodding acquaintance, but we knew every family on our side of the street. And there were children living in every one of the houses in this screen on the left-hand side. We actually played at the end of the gardens in the back alley, which I don't know if you can see my cursor, but it's, you know, it's the place where you would go to access your back gardens. We had a lot of fun there. Annalie Street, interestingly, in equally suburban Orpington, she went back and looked on her street, and she reported a very different experience, where her family knew everybody, pretty much everybody on the street, the neighbours across the road, the neighbours along the road on the same side. And when we went back, we noticed that it was 14 to 15 metres across. And when you look at that street, it's a hodgepodge of different styles, but interestingly, a scale that allows for maybe cars not to drive so fast. And perhaps all the evidence is actually suggesting that the speed of traffic has quite a big impact on whether or not you get to know your neighbours. There was a study done by the University of West of England, in fact, a few years ago, which demonstrated exactly that. That was the lady down the street that used to babysit for Annalie, Mrs. Harrison, I think. And, you know, Annalie even knew the elderly lady that lived over the road. And the piece of research I was mentioning was reported on by The Guardian about nearly 15 years ago now. And it suggests that speed of traffic in a street has an almost proportional relationship to the number of people you know in that street. And when we were researching Goldsmith Street, some of the things we were thinking about were those issues about how to make a place where you would, you know, enjoy living as a child, but also as an adult. How do we make a community? And about the same time, brilliant piece of research work came out by Dina Bornat called Making Spaces for Play, which is a free NHBC Foundation document. You can download it off the website. And her research suggested very strongly a number of kind of golden rules for making great places. I won't go through them in detail, but just to sum up, speed of traffic, very important, but really important is easy traffic-free access for children to play space, for them to roam at different ages, for them to be unattended, unsupervised, and to feel they have a degree of freedom and autonomy. It's very, very interesting how much that seems to influence not only their enjoyment of their home, but actually the sense of community. And that was reported on in their work, literally by the numbers of verbal interactions that were recorded during the day between people. And I love this. It was of all papers, the Daily Mail reporting on a bit of on a good news story, would you believe, about the back alley in Middlesbrough of a street where some relatively elderly ladies got together and turned this into this for their grandchildren to play, all by a small grant from the local authority and some key moves, one of which was securing the end of the alley so that only the residents could use it, whereas before it was open to everyone. So such a simple intervention can make such a big difference. And I often think of this when we're working on projects, because it reminds us that, you know, the details on who accesses places and who they're for is really important. So I'm going to kick off by just briefly talking about St Andrew's Riverside in Tiverton. This was a scheme we won in a competition, in fact, for Mid Devon District Council a few years ago. 39 houses and flats, all for private sale in this case, a piece of land owned by the local authority and which various development companies had come along with JVs in the past, and they'd not managed to make it work commercially. Even people like McCarthy and Stone, you know, who do, some of you may know, they do a kind of retirement developments. They couldn't make it work and they pulled out. So the local authority decided that they needed to unlock the value of this site, but also to enhance what is a very important site in the centre of Tiverton, right on the banks of the River Exe. Cheek by jowl with some lovely listed buildings, notably the town hall, you can see there overlooking the site, and also St George's Church. It's a gorgeous site. That's looking from the other side of the River Exe back towards it. And interestingly, it had never been built on. And I think that's probably a function of the flooding. When we looked at historic maps, though, Tiverton's specialness is really apparent, and it's characterised by these kind of Burbage lines, these tenement boundaries, which, as the town grew wealthier through wool production and other industries, development occurred down the lines of these original tenements. And so, as well as buildings fronting a street, you get a series of kind of secondary semi-industrial buildings along tenement lines, leading to a character of small alleyways going down towards rivers. There are two or three rivers in Tiverton, not just the Exe. And you get this very charming, very cheek by jowl arrangement of buildings, which are in the main now residential. And when we looked at, you know, trying to unlock the site and its development potential, we were very, very keen to try and engage with the, you know, the character of Tiverton as we'd seen it. So, you know, imagining a series of very simplistic diagrams dealing with the kind of quantum of accommodation required to make it work commercially. You could, of course, you know, do this. And then, of course, we looked at, you know, possibly fronting all the accommodation onto the river, but that felt wrong. Then instead we decided to bring the majority of the accommodation to the back of the site to look over smaller scale accommodation at the front. And then to introduce a kind of grain of lanes and views through, very much on the Tiverton model. And then to use some of the kind of scale of the roofscapes that we'd noticed to bring a different scale to our proposal with a series of valley roofs and gables. And then to start squinting these and shifting them, rotating them to give individuality and variety to the scheme. The Tiverton is nothing if not a collage of different materials. There's everything there, brick, tile, stone, render. And so when we look again at the existing urban grain and the tenement boundaries, and there the red dotted line, you can see our site before. And then you see the kind of scale of what we're proposing on the site. So all those black lines are effectively pathways. And I won't dwell too much on the accommodation, but to the right hand side, you see the overall site plan. So cars meander into the site. They come down a very steep slope, which we managed through traversing to the edge of the site and coming back again. And then the majority of car parking is in an undercroft under the flats to the right hand side. And then you can access the houses to the left, which are in terraces of three, via pedestrian routes that take you down to a shared garden overlooking the river. And so we were challenging overlooking distances. So, you know, in some places they're 9 meters between the houses and flats. Some places they're as low as 7. But very much taken from the Tiverton vernacular. And here's a view looking back with your, you've got your back here to the River X and the shared garden, and you're looking up the steeply sloping site back towards the flats and the entrance to the site, and between you here are the houses. So kitchens on the ground floor, bedrooms above. So whilst they're close, you know, we're talking about occupations that can tolerate being quite close, and the windows to bedrooms are staggered so they don't look straight into each other. View from the shared garden looking back and back again across, as if you've sailed across the river by zip wire. Looking back through the gaps, you can see the listed Palladian church there with its clock spire, and you can also see the top of the town hall to the left. So Goldsmith Street, so that's our work locally, and the situation with Tiverton is that it's on site. I know it's suffered some hiccups through a design and build process which hasn't been very happy, and I only mention that because I think Goldsmith Street is an exemplar process, not just in the brief we were set, which was amazing, which I'll talk a bit about, but also in the process of procuring construction teams and construction itself. So Tiverton, you know, my fingers are crossed on that one. I really hope it comes out well. We were commissioned to do a stage 4 set of information, which we did to the very best of our ability. And, you know, I think we all know the vagaries of the build and design process can sometimes lead to good outcomes and sometimes they don't. So fingers crossed there. Goldsmith Street, though, well, what is it? It's 48 flats and 43 houses. It's for Norwich City Council. It's 100% socially rented. It's built over an area of about 1.2 hectares. And as I'm sure some of you know, it was lucky enough to be given the Stirling Prize in 2019, as well as the Neave Brown Award for Housing. So it did pick up a huge number of awards, and that's incredibly gratifying. But I think if there's a legacy for Goldsmith Street, it's, I hope, that it's demonstrated that actually it's possible to make fabulous places which are engaging with the social issues of, you know, increased loneliness and the erosion of communities, and, you know, the way that children are, you know, not really, their play isn't really promoted in a lot of housing estates. That legacy, I hope, is more important than any award. I'm going to show you a short film now, which just gives you an introduction to some of the thinking. And it features Annalee Riches, my co-founder. So with no further ado, just to warn you, it's a bit of a slow start.
There's a long history of council housing. I mean, it's, you know, something that's been happening over 100 years. It's great to see that they're able to do it again, because actually, if you look back at some of the most forward-thinking and innovative housing solutions, they have come from councils. We've seen that the private sector can't deliver sufficient homes that are affordable for people. I think it's great to see more councils developing. I think one of the things that we were really concerned about was providing safe places for children to play in the scheme. So there's a number of different areas of landscaping. There are what we're calling ginnels, which are kind of glorified alleyways at the back of people's gardens where small children can play safely. They're actually kind of not publicly accessible, but they open up onto spaces like this. It was really important that children could access play spaces from their houses without crossing roads. It's very rare that a council raises the bar and says, can you do passive house? Normally your aspirations get diluted, but they did ask us, could we do a passive house scheme? And that came from them. The roofs are made of black glossy pan tiles, which are a material you see in Norwich a lot because it's quite closely linked with Holland. There's a lot of the Dutch materials that ended up here. So a lot of the buildings you see around have pan tile. I think it's really wonderful to come here when the kids are back from school and see more playing in the alleyways. It's what we hoped, but we, you know, were slightly maybe nervous about how they'd work. But actually, what people tell us is it's been a kind of mechanism for them meeting neighbours, for their kids getting to know each other and making friends. So it's, yeah, that's brilliant. It's great to see people living here.
So, how did it start? Well, it was an RIBA competition set in 2009. And this is a front page of the Norwich City Council brief, which I like. But it was a great brief. It was exciting. You know, it asked us to make a place which was connected to the wider area. It asked us to make a place that prioritize pedestrians and cyclists, to engage with the what was not then called the climate emergency, but actually to engage with issues of low carbon even then, and sustainability. So what it didn't do is ask us to, you know, spend weeks doing essays on how we add value and programs and KPIs. So you know, it was a great brief and one that we just so badly wanted to win. And we were lucky that under our then arrangement of working as Richards Hawley Mikhail architects with Kathy Hawley at the time, we had built Clayfield, which also was an RIBA competition, and that was for 28 homes in a Suffolk village, not that far from Norwich. And again, great, very challenging brief. It was really my first real introduction to the issues of sustainability and carbon. This was back in 2004-05. And I think in many ways, a really successful project, mixed social and private for a local housing association. It was meant to be an exemplar screen of a scheme of cutting edge green technologies. And, you know, we sprayed hempcrete into prefabricated timber frames. There was a district biomass boiler, and our winning entry had, you know, prioritized ideas of a solar scheme where, on the bottom right hand side, you can see our early AXO, where houses are grouped in terraces of three to evoke large barns, if you like, because of the semi-rural nature of the scheme, with small gardens and wider, larger areas for communal gathering, whether it be a small children's play area under an orchard or an allotment to the right, or a wildflower meadow, and then a larger kick around football area. So there were kind of social ideas here, but there were also very, very strongly embedded sustainability ideas. And we would never have known how successful this scheme was or otherwise had we not been, again, lucky that Burra Happold commissioned a 2-year post-occupancy evaluation. And it was 2 years because they got the first results back and couldn't quite figure. So they had to go back. And what came out was very interesting. Some of the initiatives hadn't worked as well as planned. But one thing came across loud and clear, had worked really, really well, better than anticipated. And that was the solar strategy of avoiding overshadowing and optimizing a southerly orientation. Had meant that our residents' fuel bills were much lower than expected. So we had that learning, and we're lucky to have it, I'd say, because when we looked at the brief for Goldsmith Street, here it is, here's the site dotted in red, Norwich Centre to the bottom right, and there's a castle on the mound in dark, and the river running through. You'll see we're 10 minutes walk away from the city gates. The ring road you can just make out by that large white area. And one thing I should just say about the brief, which I've kind of forgotten to mention, I'm sorry, at its heart was a real challenge, which was they wanted houses rather than flats wherever possible, but they also wanted a density here because of the city centre location they felt they could achieve of about 80 to 85 dwellings per hectare. And car use and car parking was kind of up to us, but it was clearly a conversation we could have with them. We also, in our research then, were looking, as well as the sustainability lessons from Clayfield, we were looking for exemplar schemes where, you know, it's possible to achieve that kind of density in a way which made a great place, you know, which wasn't predicated on blocks of flats and lifts. And we found it 5 minutes away from the site, and to the left hand side, shown in a darker grey, you'll see what's known as the golden and silver triangle areas of Norwich. And they are, if you look at the street patterns, you'll see Edwardian stroke Victorian terraces. And here's a picture on the right of a typical one, beige brick, some nice detailing, but very simple. Front gardens, back gardens, front doors, bedroom windows overlooking the street. And if you look at Google Earth on the left, we got our Google measuring tools out and discovered that they were 14 metres both front and back, and almost the same every street, 14 metres. And we know from you know, Kathy, who grew up in Norwich, that this was a really desirable area with a great sense of community. I should add that there's a pub on every street corner. And so the scale of the streets seemed to make sense. So when we started, you know, using lots of tracing paper to try and come up with our solution, we were very mindful of this model. And in a sense, here's our solution in abstract. It's a section through the site, which, you know, if you look at the drawing, at the left is the north and to the right is the south. So imagine you've cut a section and you're looking towards the east. We needed to develop a scheme across the site where terraces of housing would conjoin. Houses would be conjoined into terraces to minimise heat loss and to optimise the potential for solar gain by not only making terraces, but also by ensuring, just like Clayfield, that the roofs were sculpted and modelled to avoid overshadowing in the winter. So the 15 degree angle you can see in orange is the midday angle of the winter sun on the winter solstice. It's relatively arbitrary, to be honest, but it gave us a kind of solar strategy for the scheme. And importantly, you need to protect houses from overheating in the summer. And so, you know, we need to think about that as well. So our scheme is effectively this diagram of streets of 14 metres in width, with private gardens and shared gardens across the 14 metres between the bags. And if I drill down a bit closer, here's a typical street section. So in that 14 metres, every inch is essential. There's a 3 metre front garden to the sunny south-facing side of the street. There's a 1.5 metre wide pavement, 2 metre wide parking and tree pit zone, 4 metre wide carriageway, again 2 metres on the other side of the street for parking, trees and of course street lamps, and again a relatively modest 1.5 metre pavement. And here it is in context. So to the bottom right, you'll see a large area of green, and the main road into Norwich is, I don't know if you can see my cursor, I'm hoping you can, is here. And you know, you're a 10 minute bus ride away from the city, well, 5 minute bus ride and 10 minute walk from the city centre. And our scheme is effectively a series of terraces laid out thus in dark. We drill a bit closer. You can see that, you know, it was very important to us that not only were we introducing new streets and play spaces, amenity spaces, green spaces, but also that the terraces mopped up, if you like, they mopped up the poor interfaces of, you know, exposed rear fences of neighbours' gardens. So, you know, to achieve this layout, we had to design the houses in such a way that they were relatively shallow, only 8 metres deep, and that meant they had to be about 6 metres wide. So, you know, we were able, because we're not dealing with a house type which we're trying to squeeze onto the site, our house types have evolved from the kind of ideas about sustainability and solar shading, but they've also evolved from a kind of scale which is determined by the site itself. And that means that, for example, let me go back, the back gardens of the most northerly terrace are effectively back garden to back garden fence of our neighbours. And similarly to the south, you know, the terrace here, the most southerly terrace is mopping up the back garden fences of our neighbouring buildings. Now, we were, and that's why I come back to the street section, because we can only do this by being absolutely surgical with dimensions, both of streets and back gardens, front gardens, but also the houses themselves. So here's that kind of sectional sketch writ large across the whole site. And the yellow arrows, I hope you can see them, they're not that graphically strong, but that's the angle of the sun, and trying to show how the sun, even in winter, penetrates into the ground floor windows, the kitchen dining rooms of the southerly facing houses, both in the back gardens and on the streets. And there you can see the key dimensions of both the terraces and the streets and the back gardens. And that's the scheme in the overall. So there are east-west streets, east-west ginnels, we call them, which I'll talk about a bit more, but and at the end of each terrace of housing is a kind of large house, if you like, a series of one-bedroom flats over three stories. So typically two-story housing, three-story flats at the ends, and a series of places between them where people can congregate. And when we look at the site plan in a bit more detail, we see how the traffic is intentionally slowed with a raised table to the north of the site here, and a raised table at the key junctions here, and there's one over here. That parking is, I should say, 0.7 car parking spaces per dwelling, which was based on our clients' research as to the kind of typical car use of their likely tenants. And we were very lucky again with this scheme to have a really onboard transport planning officer, Bruce Bentley, who was very much a champion of this idea that, you know, rather than massive highways and huge radii, that he wanted a traffic scheme which was relatively low car use, where we could use design to slow car speeds. And he was totally on board with the idea that a car might have to wait a second whilst another car, you know, comes down the street for them to actually pass. And, you know, I don't have to say that is a really unusual accomplice to have in the planning team. And there is a typical street. So there you can see the car parking, the trees, the street lamps, the sunny side of the street on the left with the front gardens, which are massively used, by the way, with tables and chairs, just because it's so sunny. And I think, you know, we've worked really hard to make them sufficiently private and desirable places to spend a bit of time. I really like this drawing. It's a kind of elevational study showing how each house has its own coloured front door, and it also shows the degree of effort that's gone into the kind of composition of the facades, which is no mean feat when you're doing passive house, because, you know, passive house has a whole process where, you know, you have to test the size of the windows and retest them. And, you know, what starts out as a generous window ends up being a lot smaller than you imagined. And so we evolved this kind of technique for making the windows look a bit bigger, a bit more generous through these kind of coffered rendered reveals. And you can see that here on the elevation. So if I look at the plans, this is a typical what we call a south-entered house. And again, it's, you know, larger than the national space standards, but, you know, it's got some what people would consider compromises, but things that Anlie and I particularly have noticed in houses we've loved up and down the country, you know, walking straight into a generous living room, a generous kitchen dining room, which is south facing. No hallway. I mean, there is the potential to put a hallway wall in there, but, you know, we just made it open. And so the kitchen dining faces south. people use that front garden, as I say. There's also a generous back garden. Stairs and living room at the back. And so this is a two-bedroom house of which three out of the four principal rooms face south. You'll also notice that the stair takes you up to a hugely generous landing, which has been incredibly useful for people. They've used it in all kinds of ways. Some use it as a home study, which is how we'd imagined it, but others have put sofas there so they can hang out while their, you know, children are in the bath. It's a play space for sleepovers. And the reports we're getting are that it's really useful space. So this is the landing at the top of the stairs. And I should mention the section which I mentioned earlier, which is about optimizing daylight and sunlight into other people's houses, means that the ceiling height at the back of that landing and the back of the bathroom is only 1.7. You know, it's quite low, but it's still really valuable. So this is a typical street facade. You'll notice for the eagle-eyed that, you know, it's very robust front gates made with 3mm expanded aluminium on a steel frame. So incredibly robust. Same with the bin stores and the bike stores, you know, really robust stuff that usually gets mullered in housing schemes. And so, you know, we had to bring this scheme in for £1,800 per square meter to be both passive house and, you know, to last a very long time and to achieve all the kind of things we wanted to achieve socially. And so there was a lot of iterations about, you know, specification, and I could talk for a very long time about that, so I better probably shut up. This is our color chart for the front doors, which I really like. I want to talk a bit about the flats. Each flat is one bedroom. There are a few two bedrooms actually, but most of them are one bedroom at the end of the terraces. And as I said, they're thought of as large houses, if you like. There are no lifts anywhere in the scheme. There are also no shared internal common parts, places which can become problematic for landlords and local authorities. So what we've got instead is every flat, ground first and second, has its own front door at pavement level. And that means instead of one staircase taking you up and having a front door off a landing and shared common parts, instead there's a front door, a generous lobby on the ground for bikes or prams, and then your own staircase taking you up to either your flat on the first floor or your flat on the second floor. And that's achieved with a kind of scissor stair. Each flat on the ground floor has a significant private garden on the back, or if it's at first floor or second floor, a significant external south-facing balcony. So these are really unusual, these flats, and I'm really proud of them. They are really lovely, and, you know, I think there's a real sense of ownership and pride that comes from having your front door on the street. And of course, you know, it activates the street, having those front doors. And here you can see it a bit more clearly. So, you know, coloured front doors paired onto the main street and one on the side. So you can see the balconies there. You can also see the glossy black pan tiles on the roof that Annalie mentioned earlier, which are very much a kind of East Anglian thing. This is about quality at street level, you know, and kind of eking out relationships by thinking about very small dimensions. So, for example, along the bottom of the terraces, you've got a small planting strip. In some cases, it's only 300 mil deep, but it makes a huge difference to the sense of kind of greenery, but also the sense of privacy to people that may have a living room window at ground floor, say, without defensible space. And this is the condition here. But even they have integrated plantation shutters, which are such a success that now everybody wants them. But, you know, for us, it was about ring fencing things of value. And you know, we specified them for those that had living rooms at ground floor without a front garden. You can also see the expanded aluminium bin stores to the right hand side, and they're incredibly robust, as they need to be. So just a few things about Passive House. We, as Annalise said, we had a solar scheme when we started, and it was a local authority that had great feedback from some residents they had interrogated about their new passive houses, and such that they were prepared to, you know, push the boat out, and they asked us, you know, could we translate our solar scheme into a passive house scheme? And I had lots of preconceptions, I'll be absolutely honest, about passive house, one of which was wrong, which was that, you know, you couldn't have windows on the north side, wrong. Another one was you couldn't open your windows in the winter, wrong. So, you know, I came to the party not really knowing enough about it to say, yes, we can do it. So I went away and was lucky enough to read an article which was talking about Sally Godber's involvement in a passive house scheme, and her company Warm, we got in to talk about it, and they became our kind of experts and really nursed us through the whole process. So we owe Warm a lot, and I know they're down in Exeter, Plymouth way, so they may be in the room even. So thank you, Sally, and her team. So some key points for design. Air tightness has to be less than 0.6 air changes per hour. And just to give you some idea, building regulations only ask for 5 at 50 pascals pressure. So, you know, what's that? It's about 10 times, isn't it? So you need to really be on it with air tightness. Obviously you need high insulation levels, but it also means triple glazing. And so, you know, to do that affordably is a big challenge. What I love about Passive House, it also tests for overheating in the summer. And so that starts to become part of the conversation. So, you know, we avoided overheating by using the solar shading over the south facing windows. And there we use the brise soleils of expanded aluminium, again, very robust and long lasting. And there you can see them. And I particularly like the expanded aluminium mesh because it's got a kind of orientation, which means that from inside the room, when you look up at the sky, you can't see the sky because of the orientation of the mesh. But from the street, when you look up, you see straight through it. It's a really lovely benefit of that particular material. And there you can see the construction for the architects and engineers in the room and anybody else that's interested in how these things are built. So it's a brick skin, half a brick skin, very much about, you know, a decision that's very much about the robustness of buildings which are brushed up against on the street, but also a very local material. I'm very aware of the embodied carbon in brick. I'm you know, something we fight against. I'm really looking forward to the first zero carbon fueled brick factory. I don't know when that's going to happen, but I don't know why it hasn't yet. Maybe somebody can tell me. But the construction here is predominantly cellulose. It's timber frame and recycled newspaper, warm cell in this case, blown into a timber prefabricated timber frame by an Irish company called Signum that had worked predominantly on schools before this. And we've done a carbon analysis, and it's in the region of the 2030 RIBA benchmark of about 300 kg per square metre. So in spite of the brick and the aluminium, it's actually very good. So some key points for your design when you're doing passive house. Air tightness has to be, 0.6, not 5. Very high insulation levels and triple glazing. Use solar gains, and your master planning and your arrangement of buildings around the site is essential for this. It's not always possible to face due south and make a great place, I know that, but it always needs to be tested as a our first go-to. Avoid overheating, using passive means, external sunshading. And I would just make a point here that if you're facing east and west, I know they say east-west is best and it can make great houses, but it's a real challenge to manage overheating if your windows are facing east and west. It's expensive and difficult. Lastly, ventilation. You of course need a whole house ventilation system, but you even need that for building regs these days. So it's just important that you think about, getting that properly detailed so that it's acoustically baffled and in the right place in the house. So we work very closely with both Warm but also Green Gauge, also in the Southwest, our energy consultants who did a fully detailed NBS spec and drawings. And here you see the BIM drawings that they worked on with us. So it was fully coordinated in BIM. Brought on a lorry, most of the timber frame, and craned onto site. And then the Warm cell is blown and then certified by the company doing the installation. Every vertical panel is blown to a certain pressure and then a certificate produced. And here's some of the materials we've used. And I would just say that, the squaring of all those things, achieving passive house affordably and bringing in build quality is nigh on impossible. And I have to thank my team, Henry and James, particularly in Mikhail Rich's, who were just so resolute working with our client, Andrew Turnbull. We had a horror when the tenders came back of, it being about 2 million over what the QS said it would be. It had to be 14 million. It came in two more than that, about 16. And, again, to his credit, maybe we lucked out, but Andrew said, do you know what? James, Henry, David, you've been, on it throughout the whole process. I want you to lead the value engineering process. And I'm going to ring fence a few things. I was very surprised when Andrew ring fenced Passive House, actually. That was the thing that he ring fenced. And with that in mind, we set about our task of taking 2 million off the build cost. It wasn't easy, but interestingly, the glossy black pantail tiles saved about £250,000 against the zinc that was originally specified. But we worked very closely with lots of suppliers directly and got their promise on prices. We worked with Crest Bricks and Tiles, who are fabulous, and I would recommend them to anyone. And there we have it. So what's happened since Goldsmith Street? Well, we actually won this programme of work for York before the Stirling, but I think taking them to see Goldsmith Street was, had a part to play in winning this work. It's a programme of delivering 600 homes across 7 sites in York. 3 have been submitted for planning. 2 have got planning and are just about to go out to tender. And again, we saw the brief. It was a competition, in this case, not an RIBA competition, but one set up by the housing delivery team themselves. And it was overdue compliant and all the rest of it. But, you know, what really stood out was the ambition and the language that was used. It was, again, one we just felt we could answer the questions, for God's sake. You know, they were about how do you deliver a great place? You know, how do you make places of long lasting quality, and how do you engage with, you know, all the issues of loneliness and sustainability, and how do you do that affordably? That was the brief, and that was what they wanted. And, you know, we got to it, and we're lucky enough to win it. So I just want to stress to any clients out there, if you want great outcomes, you know, have some thought about, you know, writing briefs that attract the people you want to work with. And they, after we were appointed, Michael and his team set about building a consensus across the council for their programme. And this is, again, an example of a great client, just like Andrew at Norwich. Great clients are people who get consensus amongst the people they need to get on board to get a great outcome. And this is an example. So Michael and his team put together this guide, which didn't just come off his desk. It was the result of lots of conversations he had with people in various parts of the council. And it became the kind of Bible that, you know, they're able to refer to when they have difficulty, maybe with, you know, an issue around parking or you know, traffic or bike storage, or, you know, and it's something which I just tip my hat off to them. The politics there are kind of green labour, and they have members who are very interested in a zero carbon solution to providing new housing, and that's certainly part of the of the brief here. So like Goldsmith Street, 100% passive house, they're also targeting zero carbon in use, and they're asking us to look at the embodied carbon in construction. This is an image of one of the sites. It's Duncan Barracks, former military site, like lots of the sites in York we're looking at. And unlike Goldsmith Street, this is about making a significant shared green space surrounded by zero carbon homes. This is a larger scheme known as Burn Home, about 100 homes, very similar themes. And, you know, lots of the DNA of Goldsmith Street, but kind of tweaked around both the place and the wider context of York. And I'll talk a bit more detail about a third scheme, which has just gone in for planning in York, called Ordnance Lane. It's got some existing buildings on the site, some significant military buildings, and has the kind of scale which is allowing us to make terraces of housing and flats which are just a bit more generous in their backs. So the back to backs here in the region of 20 meters rather than 14. And that means that kind of shared ginnel space is more significant. And this perspective done by Amir in the office, our year out student, who is just so talented, is illustrating our idea of, you know, shared space, but it's private. You know, like the alleyway I showed you in Middlesbrough at the very beginning, this is only for the residents that live in the terraces or flats at the end. And again, the DNA of the site, the scheme is, you know, in this section. So deeper houses than Goldsmith Street, because the site allowed us to make deeper houses. So, you know, with their super thick insulated walls, they're about 11 meters deep. 2 meter front gardens, more generous footpaths because of the nature of the roads. But, you know, very similar ideas, but much wider shared garden spaces. And in this case, as in all the York schemes, we're having to focus on two things which we didn't at Goldsmith Street. One is the provision of lots of PVs to achieve net zero carbon on site. So roofscapes have to be cognizant of getting the right number of PVs on. Also, interestingly, because York is that much further north, actually we get less benefit from winter sun because the winter sun's a little bit lower. So all that's kind of been taken into the mix when we're working on our passive house calculations. Again, what's come from the client, York, here is a real interest in themes that we wouldn't have necessarily been exposed to, and I'm so grateful to them for that. One of them is shown here. It's the idea of an intergenerational house. You know, on the corner of a terrace, instead of three flats, we've got a really generous duplex above a ground floor flat, organized in such a way that you can imagine easily sharing with elderly relatives living on the ground floor. And that's the latest CGI. You've got your back to an existing really significant building called the Married Quarters, which is being turned into a ground floor communal stroke cafe space. So you're sitting having a cup of coffee, maybe talking about the communal growing that's happening in this shared space. And we're working with a number of York-based charities that are going to provide those facilities. So it's kind of joined up, local authority joined up thinking with the wider stakeholders to make, you know, a great place. Here you're looking at the intergenerational housing with its super generous first floor balcony looking over the communal growing space and orchard. So that's York, super exciting. And it feels very much like a kind of natural progression from our work in Clayfield and Norwich. Well, I'm sure many of you know Park Hill, iconic early 60s building overlooking Sheffield where Annalee went to architecture school. So it's a very, very important building for her. We were delighted to win the competition to think about phase two, after the success of phase one done by Hawkins Brown and Egre West. So there's the bit we're doing, phase two. That's the section. So streets in the sky. Each street serves three floors, each street wide enough to take a milk float, would you believe? There's phase one. Phase two on the right. Tom Bloxham in the interview said, this is all very well, but phase one costs too much. We need to do it for £100 a square foot. Do you think you're up to it? We swallowed hard and said, yeah, well, maybe. Let's have a look. So we noticed that a lot of the residents, well, we were given our own flat. That's the other thing. They did a 2-week process. They said, you've been shortlisted. You're one of five. Here's your flat. Here are the keys. We'll see you there in 2 weeks' time. And the brief was kind of excite us. You know, very, very different to Norwich and York, but genius in its own way. This was the flat we had. We noticed that, well, actually, it wasn't our flat. This was another one. But we noticed a lot of the residents had decorated the bits outside, the balconies. This was the flat we had. So a bit of lipstick pointing and white painted brick. And we came and did a presentation where we effectively graffitied the walls with our ideas. And our idea was this, it was to keep the brick, change the windows, and to give each resident what they obviously wanted, which was the sense of their own personality on their flat. And we were doing that with insulation, coloured render, and a sequence of colours which were not necessarily individual to each flat, but sufficiently different for you to be able to know where your flat is from a distance. And interestingly, Raina Bannum, when we went back and looked at the original reviews for Park Hill, Raina Bannum's only criticism was that residents didn't necessarily know which flat was theirs when they saw it from a distance. Here's some models we made showing what that colouring of the reveals might look like from within the flat. And there's us on the day, on the morning of the presentation, Alim and Cameron doing an image which shows how, with our idea, you wouldn't really see the coloured reveals unless you were looking at it from an angle. but from face on, it would just look like a really straightforward refurbishment of the original. There we go. I'm not going to have time to talk about it in any more detail, so I'll just nip through some images, call it a day. And this is taken from last week. So we're unveiling late summer, early autumn. And that's cleaned up with new windows. That isn't the side which has the coloured reveals, which has still got the scaffolding on it. But it's looking super smart, I think. There we go. Thank you very much, everyone.
David, thank you so much for an enlightening and inspiring presentation. The time is now 12:08, so we're going to start going through some questions. But we're respectful of everybody's time, so we are going to close the session at 12:30. So apologies in advance if we don't manage to get through all of the questions. So we'll make a start. Actually, with one from me, so that's okay. It's just really thinking about how your work focuses on how people interact and the spaces that enable this. And obviously, over the last year, we've had to change a bit how we think about these spaces. So I was just wondering if you think this will have a lasting legacy in terms of design, or whether we revert to how we were before. We've obviously been trying to spread out a bit more, but now I think there might be a drive to bring people back together again. I just wondered what you thought about that.
Who knows? I mean, all I can say is that I think everybody is questioning anew, with homeschooling in particular, questioning anew the idea of open plan. Interestingly, when we did Clayfield, we did a survey of potential residents, and you know, any socially rented resident was not interested in open plan. And how wise were they? Because you know, when you've got limited space, open plan can be a challenge. It depends who you talk to. So when Annalie was at a conference recently, you know, she was saying, you know, this will lead to less car use and more people using bikes, and somebody else in the room from a house builder was saying, no, it's brilliant, we're going to provide 2.5 car parking spaces per house now, you know. So there, it depends who you talk to, doesn't it? I think the provision of incidental spaces where you can just hole up with a laptop and work from home, like the study in Goldsmith Street houses, is going to be more useful than ever. And so maybe it'll start to lead to architects thinking about those incidental uses a bit. But I don't have a crystal ball. I can't really tell you over and above that.
That's fair enough. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, I can see there's a comment from Chris Holdsworth saying that their new net zero carbon brick factory will hopefully be up and running producing bricks in 2024. So that sounds very good news. So
Where's that?
It doesn't say. I'm not sure where that is.
Well, thank you. I look forward to seeing that. But I keep wondering why we can't use all the British woodlands to fuel a net zero brick factory. So British woodlands, for those of you who are interested, it's my pet love, are all massively overstood and overshadowed and desperately need somebody to work them, but it's not commercially viable. So I'm hoping somebody's going to come out of the woodwork and set up that brick factory from British woodland fuel. Just throwing it out there, I haven't got enough time to do it, so you know, maybe somebody else could.
Sounds like a good idea. Okay, the next question from Joe Grant says, thank you for an amazing presentation. For the Goldsmith Passive House scheme, did you have MVHR installed? And there have been arguments that homeowners struggle to understand how to use equipment properly. So there are energy performance gaps. There's an argument that sometimes lower tech, easier to use solutions are better than expensive high tech, which ends up being used wrong. So what do you think about that?
Yeah, it's a very good question. I mean, I've had my own personal problems with MVHR in the house that I built. So, you know, I'm not going to sit here and say there are no problems. Okay, so you can't really achieve building regs, never mind passive house, without an MVHR. At Goldsmith Street, we work very hard with Green Gauge to make sure that the controls are super easy. So there's literally three modes on one switch. That's it. You know, and you don't really play with it unless you go on holiday or you want a boost. So there's nothing difficult about it. What's more challenging is the maintenance. And so you kind of need filter changes every 6 months. And so a landlord or a tenant have to deal with that, which is, you know, not without its problems. We haven't had POA done yet, post occupancy analysis yet done on Goldsmith Street. And we're really hoping to get that done. But some of the feedback we've had from some residents suggests that there's one resident that's mentioned apocryphally that somebody else has mentioned that their house overheats. So it may or may not be true, but we suspect that's because of not because of the whole house ventilation, but because of the myth around passive house that you can't open windows. So, yeah. I did also mention that they're very high quality passive house units at Goldsmith Street by a company called Paul, the kind of Rolls Royce of whole house ventilation systems. And again, Green Gauge were really on it designing the ducting out of galvanized steel pipe and really nailing down the acoustic baffling and making sure all that was in place. So, you know, like with all these things, it's about the quality of the design and the quality of the product as much as it is about the control system. If that helps.
Yeah, thanks for that. I can just see there's a follow-up comment. So the net zero carbon brick factory is Ibstock in the West Midlands. So something to look forward to.
Yeah, well done, Ibstock.
Okay, next question. Were there any issues with accessibility for the first and second floor flats? Notice no lifts on the plan. So could you explain a bit about that?
Yeah, so it's a balance, isn't it? Yes. The first and second floor flats probably wouldn't pass the latest set of building control regulations. Unless you get a waiver. In our case, the ground floor flats were M43 lifetime homes. So, you know, the client took the decision that on balance, you know, there were sufficient accessible flats across the scheme to meet their needs and all possible future needs. I know there's an argument that, you know, you should make every floor of every dwelling accessible. But, you know, there's a balance to be struck. And, you know, I would like to think we struck the right balance, but I know if I were a wheelchair user, I'd probably think otherwise.
Fair enough. Okay, so has there been consideration of a car-free scheme that moves away from a traditional layout around a vehicle-dominated carriageway?
Has there been consideration of it?
That's right, one that moves away from, well, I think it's asking if you considered designing without any cars at all, moving away from vehicles totally.
York is York. The schemes in York, the one I showed you, Ordnance Lane, is significantly less cars than Goldsmith Street. I'm afraid I don't have the numbers to hand, but even there, we needed some M43 car parking. So typically in London, our schemes were looking at 10% or less car parking. But you still need deliveries and you still need people to be able to get to your house to move furniture and stuff. So it's not as if you can do without roads. Although some roads in York, we are designing so that, you know, they're quite short and you access them, you know, on foot from the end of the road. Totally car free is something we would aspire to, but it's very hard to achieve in practice. I mean, at Nailsy, I haven't had a chance to talk about Nailsy today, but at Nailsy, you know, we were being effectively lambasted in the planning committee for not providing more than 2 car parking spaces per home. So, you know, it depends on so many things, the culture of the local authority and members. We have to respond to that. We can't just be making the rules up, obviously. But we always aspire to low car use, obviously. I would have thought that was clear in our presentation.
Yeah, thanks for that. That makes total sense. Okay, next question. Actually, I think it's a compliment to start with. So from John Wild, who's loving the burb bulb aesthetic behind you. I think that's behind you. Yep. So, and also he's totally blown away by the user and community focused sustainable schemes shown today. And looking forward to seeing the Tiverton scheme and hope that the design and build influence does not compromise the scheme's obviously strong streetscape. So some very complimentary comments from John there. Thanks for that. Do you want to respond to that?
Thank you, John. And the what influence background?
It's your light bulb without a shade. I think he's talking about the aesthetic of the of that.
Yeah. No comment.
Okay, well, we'll move on to Sarah Lee from Stryker Clown. He says, that's a brilliant presentation. Thank you, David. And can she ask what you think about how planning policy or building regulations should be changed and used to make sure that all new projects and clients have to provide better performing buildings as soon as possible in response to the climate emergency?
Oh my God, that's such a big question. I'm not really the kind of person that thinks long and hard about policy. All I know is that the Future Homes Standard doesn't look from the initial forays, you know, coming out of government, it doesn't look as if it's going to be particularly onerous, which is a bit worrying. I'm also massively worried about the idea of kind of design by I'm sorry, I've forgotten the expression, but design guides, that's right. Yeah, I'm really worried about the design guide ethos coming out of government at the moment. I don't think we would have responded well to a design guide, and I don't think we need design guides. But yeah, I can't really answer that question. Have you got another one for me?
Well, actually, we're lucky enough to have Andrew Forth from our policy team from the RIBA with us today. So we're thinking that perhaps that would be something he would like to jump in on and explain what the RIBA is doing in terms of lobbying.
Thank you very much. I think the main thing that is on our minds about the planning and building regulations reforms at the moment is that there is nowhere near enough detail in a lot of them. The planning white paper, which was published last year, says everything's going to be sorted soon. And how much of the system is actually determined by, how much of the output is actually determined by the planning system? You know, how much of it, you know, actually is about local, you know, clients being made to value quality or sustainability? I think there are obviously things which are harder to do, and you know, we've talked a bit around, you know, some of the challenges around accessibility and whether those issues could be dealt with. But I think the government, governments like to change the planning system because it's something they can do to say they're doing something and it doesn't cost a lot of money. We have a huge housing crisis in this country. I think at some point we're going to have to spend a lot of money tackling it, but why not tinker with the planning system? There's a whole lot of briefing material on the RIBA website, and we will be publishing a whole load of stuff coming up on things around changes to the building regs and to the building safety. And there are also things like we send out a weekly update of political events at Westminster, and there is a whole range of sort of materials for architects published by our practice team, which sort of set out what they're doing. So speak to John or colleagues at RIBA Southwest and they can put you in touch with us. But I think the main thing about it is it's all still up for debate, and the more people who have strong views and are able to communicate them to people making the decisions, the better. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Andrew. Yeah, I think it's important for members to know just how much the RIBA is actually doing behind the scenes that we don't always get to hear about. So thanks, that was really helpful. Okay, we've got another question for David, which is about the rear play areas. So LM says, like the rear play areas between the gardens, but wondered how are these to be maintained long term? Perhaps the residents have adopted this?
So the play areas at Goldsmith Street are adopted by the local authority. So they have a maintenance team that, you know, deal with all the public parks and communal areas anyway. And, you know, the decision was made by the client that they would be adopted. So, and that's probably a function of the fact that they're, you know, they're 100% socially rented. I would love in the schemes in York for there to be a kind of adoption by residents association kind of arrangement, because they're not adopted by the local authority, and I think the expectation is they're going to be part of the service charge and managed by a company, just like, you know, the other green spaces are. But I like the idea of you know, very, very hyper local adoption by the terrace. That would be terrific, but we don't have that expectation yet. But I think that will, I mean, York are very good at listening, and I think if that comes out of the residents that move in, they'll probably, you know, action it.
Yeah, that sounds really encouraging. I just see there's another comment from our sponsors, Ibstock, who would like to note that the first UK buildings building materials manufacturer to now procure all their electricity from pure green resources. So that's worth knowing. Thanks for that. Okay, moving on to a question from Emma Osmondson. What would be your dream commission?
Actually, Emma, that's such a good question, isn't it? I think what we're working on is just so exciting. I'm not sure. Can I come back to you on that? I don't really know. That's such a good question. I know you, Emma, and we've chatted, and you didn't ask me that then. But yeah, I'll come back to you. My dream commission, I'll have to give that some thought.
Okay, well, we'll move on to the next question then, which is about the use of the shared gardens between the homes in the Clayfield scheme. What has the feedback been like on shared rather than private per home gardens?
Sorry, I didn't quite understand the question.
I think what's the feedback been like on shared gardens rather than having private individual gardens?
Oh, well, whenever I've been there, the kids are just ecstatic. And, you know, I've been thanked personally a number of times by tots and small children. And certainly the families I've got to know have talked, you know, very movingly about how they've got to know their neighbours really well quickly, and their kids play, and, you know, Nevaeh is a little girl, Louis I've got to know particularly well, and his wife, and they talk really movingly about how Nevaeh's made loads of friends quickly, and how they've made friends. And, you know, obviously that's their experience and it won't be shared by everyone. I know somebody else who is a single lady who's got some health challenges. She lives on a ground floor flat, and she laughingly grumbles about, you know, Kid Mageddon outside her back garden. But it's all very good natured. And, you know, when pushed, she said she really loves it. And there's another really nice film which the Housing Design Awards commissioned after we won the Housing Design Awards for Goldsmith Street on our website. Anybody can access it. It's 5 minutes, which is why I didn't show it today. But in it, you get to hear the residents a bit more and you get to hear their opinion about things like that. It's well worth it if you could spare 5 minutes to watch it. So generally, I would say the shared aspect, I've only heard good things. I'm sure there will be some that think their garden could have been maybe a meter longer. But actually, you always needed access with an alleyway of some sort for bins and bikes. So that what we did is that meter just became, in some places, maybe 3 meters, in some places, 2 meters. So it was just about making what was essential into something which had the promise of being more, you know. And I go right back to my original slide, you know, it's about kids having unstructured, unsupervised play where their parents feel relatively comfortable that they're okay.
Yep, that was great, thank you. We've got time for one final question. So we've got Derek Jackson from Cohort Architects. He says, amazing presentation, thank you. And have you done any work making older existing terraces low energy use, and do you have any tips? But we've only got a couple of minutes, so I don't know if you can, any quick tips on that?
Yeah, the tip is it's really difficult, isn't it? It's really difficult. So we're doing a terrace, the married quarters, as part of our scheme in New York I showed. It's probably about 30 metres long, 40 metres long actually. Three-storey, little dormer windows. And, you know, it's hugely challenging to bring it to Passive House standards. Even Enerfit, you know, it's kind of slightly outside our budget. So I don't have any tips, except that there we are in conversation with the Civic Trust, who were brilliant. And they said, meeting only last week, they said, well, look, you know, if it means that you might need to lose the dormer windows on the roof to bring it to a more sustainable standard, you know, we'd be up for that. So I suppose maybe what we're going to have to do if we're going to bring our building stock up to standard is lose some of the twiddly bits that we love. That's the challenge. I think that's the challenge we face. I'm somebody that loves the twiddly bits. So, you know, that's troubling for me, but I think we might have to lose them.
Thank you. That was brilliant. So, yeah, thank you so much for your time this afternoon, David. It was fascinating. And I particularly found it interesting to hear how you've heard feedback from the people that have moved into your schemes. And I think that we should all kind of endeavour to hear what people actually have to say about the things that we design. And I think that's so useful for future designs and schemes that we develop. And yeah, also thanks, Andrew, for your input as well. And on behalf of the team at RIBA Southwest, thank you for everybody that attended, for taking your time out of your busy schedule to speak to us. Thanks to Ibstock Brick for sponsoring this event. We look forward to seeing you as the series continues with new events to be advertised shortly. So don't miss out and keep an eye on the RIBA newsletter, all the social media platforms, and follow the RIBA Southwest on Eventbrite to get all of the notifications in your inbox. So we'll see you all soon. Thank you and have a good afternoon.